morning, church. Nice to see everyone here this morning. We are going to make a head start now. So if we can all please stand up as we sing our first song called Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Justified. very good morning, folks. It is brilliant to be here and to be able to worship together. Now, today is Remembrance Sunday, and I thought it'd be appropriate for us to hold a minute's silence in remembrance of those who have given their lives, who have fought, who had died to ensure the safety and the freedom of this country. Now, I know traditionally it's done at 11 o'clock, but seeing as though we don't start our service until 11:30, we'll take the opportunity now to hold Remembrance Day by being in silence for a minute. Afterwards, I'll pray. Let's remember and honor those who have gone. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that we have this opportunity to gather together, a group of your people ready to hear from you, ready to be taught by you from your word, ready to be conformed into the image of Christ as a result of what we hear, and ready to worship and honor our Savior. And Father, this Remembrance Sunday, we do want to remember those who have given their lives to ensure the freedom of the people of this country. Ultimately, we want to give you thanks, for we know that all things are in your hands. Father, we commit ourselves to you today and ask, won't you please, in your grace and in your mercy, see fit to bless us in helping us understand your word? And won't you please see fit to help us in worshiping and in honoring you? Won't you please work through your spirit to mold us as individuals and as a collective body into the image of your precious Son, in whose name we ask. Amen. All right. Well, here's our big three. And again, I want to remind us that the big three isn't just for filler. It's to remind us that there is a need, a gospel emphasis in our daily lives. So let's pray and remember the big three throughout this week. Our missionary for the week, we want to think about and pray for, Mark Coffey and his family. They are missionaries over to South Africa. The country for the week is the country of Guam. So let's pray for the people of Guam and the country there. It's got less than a fifth of a million, but they still need the gospel. So let's pray for them. And our county for the week, I had to look this one up and look up the pronunciation, is Merthyr Tydfil, and it's in Wales. The population there is 55,700. And again, people who are in dire and desperate need of the gospel. So as we think about our missionary for the week, the country and the county for the week, let us be burdened with a heart's desire to preach the gospel and to make Jesus known in our own sphere of influence. Our notices for the week: on Wednesday, 7 p.m., we have our Bible study and youth meeting. Saturday, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., we have our Bible Institute. Come and join us and learn and be changed. And 11:15 a.m. Saturday as well, after the Bible Institute, we have our community outreach, where we as a body get to go out and share the gospel. So that's our weekly notices, happening every week unless things change. Here's our upcoming events. We have on a Sunday night our evening services, which we began about a month and a half ago. Let's continue to attend this, to support this, and learn more about what the Bible tells us. So Sunday evenings, 5 p.m., surveying the books of the Bible. And we also want to keep in mind that we have our winter retreat, the 7th to the 9th of January 2022. And we keep mentioning it every week. We just want everyone to be aware that it's on and to be excited about it. And we'll look forward to seeing you there. There are more details of it on our church website. After the service, we are celebrating the Lord's table, the Lord's Supper. The Lord Jesus commanded that we do this to remember him, to look back and know who he is, what he did, and why that is so important in our lives. So we have the opportunity as a body to act in obedience in remembering the Lord Jesus Christ, our wonderful Savior. So that's at the end of the service, followed by our membership class. So if you are thinking of becoming a member, or you're interested or have any questions or queries as to what church membership is, please come along to the membership class after the Lord's Supper, where we'll go through why we think it's important, what it's all about, and by the end of it, you'll not have become a member. It's just something for you guys to consider about becoming a member. Now we'll invite our brother Travis, and he'll be giving us our offering devotion.
Our offering devotion's just more of a, I guess you would say, a notice about one of the ways in which you can give, of course, is alongside giving through gift aid. So a number of people in our church who are UK taxpayers have opted in for this. And basically, if you're not familiar with it, you've probably heard of it, but it allows our church to claim back 25%, I think, is that right, Love Day, on all donations that you give that you've paid tax on. So if you're not a UK taxpayer, then we can't do that, but we are able to claim back some on what's called small cash donations. So any donation up to £30 that just comes in, if you're not a UK taxpayer, we can also claim tax back on that. So if you're interested in that, you can speak to Love Day or me. But the forms are out in the entryway there, and they're just, there's like a rack there, and it just says gift aid forms and explains what you do there. So that's been a real help to us as a church. There's obviously no pressure whatsoever, but if you do that, you do need to register, and then our finance team will be able to go in and claim that. So just a notice about that. It's a big help to us as a church. Obviously, we don't rely on that necessarily, and we hope you don't think, great, I can give 25% less. But the goal would be eventually that we could put that in special projects, like maybe a building fund or that type of thing. So that is our notice for the offering. So Jeffrey and Jeff, Jeffron and Jeffrey, sorry, getting you guys confused there. If you guys can help us with the offering this morning. And if our musicians will go ahead and come up and lead us in our next song, which is My Jesus, I Love Thee. So go ahead, guys, and come and sing for us. And while they sing, the men will receive our offering.
Oh,
Thank you very much. If you have your Bibles, we turn to the book of Titus, chapter 1. We'll read there in just a moment. But let's pray and ask God's blessing on our service and on the offering that we've received this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you've given to us. Thank you for all of your many goodnesses to us, Lord. Thank you that you daily load us with many benefits. And God, we are so very thankful that we can bring you our praises today, that we can bring you our offerings, that most importantly, we can bring you our lives. And Lord, we want to dedicate ourselves to you and the praises, the gifts, the worship we give you. We want that to flow out of hearts that truly love you. And so thank you for allowing us to gather, and we pray you'll bless the offering, you'll bless the request. We work in the our country, Guam, the Coffee family, and Merthyr Tydfil, the county of the week. Lord, work in these needs and in all the needs of our church family. We pray for your help. Bless our time in your word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so Titus chapter 1, this is a new series for us that we're going to be going through the book of Titus. We finished, we had a guest speaker last week. The week before last, we finished a series on spiritual gifts. And I did want to say a note, and I'm hoping I will get out some kind of, whether it's a WhatsApp message or an email to everybody, a little bit more about that. But the point of this series wasn't just to inform us all about what everyone else ought to be doing with their spiritual gifts, but for each of us to be considering and asking the Lord to guide us into how we can use our gifts, or just to be encouraged to continue using our gifts. So, you know, and there are many different practical ways that you can be involved, whether it's in some ministry of the church, or in some ministry through the church, or perhaps there's a gift you feel God has given you, and you would say, could this be used in some way as part of the Down and Baptist Church? So I would encourage you to think about that and think about what is God putting in your heart? And He may have particularly and especially equipped you in a way that could be a blessing to the whole body and ever can be encouraged through that. So do pray and consider that. And maybe you're just not sure, and in which case we'll give you the least desirable job. No, I'm just joking. But, you know, maybe you're not sure and you would like some encouragement or some counsel on how you could be involved. Ricardo, myself, Sam, one of the other workers in our church would be happy to try to help you. Okay, so Titus chapter 1, let's read beginning verse 1, and we will read down to verse number 4 to start with today. So the Bible says, Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began, but hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. To Titus, mine own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace, from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ our Savior. So we are in a new book this morning, and I've entitled the message this morning, Introductions, which is kind of appropriate because we're in the introduction of the book. But, you know, introductions can be quite important. It's kind of rude, isn't it, if you walk into a room and you don't introduce yourself, or no one seeks to get to know you and then seeks to introduce you to others. And that's just kind of on a side note, a good thing for us to always be aware, especially at church. Who is visiting? Have we introduced ourselves? And have we introduced them to others? And obviously, you can do too little on that, and you can do too much. And I've seen in churches where, you know, the visitor is like embarrassed and never wants to come back because they make it such a big deal. Come up and sing us a special, you're new, you know. Not quite like that, but not exactly the best way. But introductions are very important. They kind of set the stage for a conversation. You want to try to capture someone's name. You want to get to know just a little bit about them, give them your name, and then hopefully that can further your conversation and perhaps a friendship can begin. Well, here in these first four verses, we're introduced to two individuals, Paul and Titus. This is the beginning of a letter from Paul the Apostle to a young man named Titus. Titus is described in verse 4 as a son after the common faith. So this wasn't Paul's biological son, but there was a sense in which they had a close relationship. Either Titus became a Christian through the preaching and ministry of Paul, or he had become a Christian and Paul simply had helped him to disciple and to teach him, and they had a very, like, almost like a father-son relationship. Titus, you know, we don't know a lot about his background except the fact that he was a Gentile. That's mentioned in Galatians chapter 2, verse 3. But he was a very faithful and trustworthy servant and co-laborer with Paul. Does anybody know what was the most difficult church, or probably the most difficult church in the Bible? Does anybody know where that church was? It starts with a C. Corinth. And there's more written to that church than any other church, and that wasn't necessarily good. It's kind of like if you're on a first name basis with the headmaster at school, well, not that you'd ever be on a first name basis, but if you know him real well and he knows you real well, that may not be for good reasons. You know, that might be because you're always there getting told off. And so the church at Corinth, there's a lot said to it, but Titus was Paul's messenger to the church at Corinth, and he went back and forth several times. Paul trusted Titus to deal with a difficult situation, and I think that speaks to the type of person that he was. Sometime between Paul's imprisonment in Rome the first time, which takes place at the end of Acts 28, when he's put in prison, then he gets out. Sometime between then and when Paul will go back to Rome to be imprisoned and to die for his faith, he and Titus visited a place called Crete. Anybody been to Crete before? Have we been to Crete before? I think we've... No. Yeah, not sure. We went to some island in the Mediterranean. I can't remember. I think it was actually Crete, yeah. We're forgetting things. But they visited Crete, and then Paul left, and Titus stayed behind. If you look down in verse number 5, Paul says, "For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting and ordain elders in every city." So then Titus was left behind in a sense, carry on the work and to especially put elders in the churches there in every city. So that's a little bit of the background of this book. But this book, I think, is going to be helpful to us because, first of all, it's going to help us to see the type of elder or pastor a church should have. And that's important for us. It's also going to help us see the importance of good leadership in the church, because there will be those that will come in to deceive the church with false doctrine and who will want to corrupt the church with impure living. Leadership is very important in any place, and especially in the church, spiritually speaking. It's also going to give some detailed instructions for how discipleship and relationship should happen within the church. What are the older men meant to be doing? What are the older women meant to be doing? Not that we have any older women. It's a little bit of a joke, but what are the younger men meant to be doing? What are the younger women meant to be doing? And we have loads of those. Everybody fits in those last two categories. So it's a helpful book, and it's going to give some very personal insights from Paul to Titus about how a church should run. But we're going to look at three words today, three ways that Paul and Titus are introduced, and three things that these will teach us about how we might consider living our lives. So the first one you can write down is number one, a servant. A servant. So this is found, verse number one, Paul, a servant of God. Paul, a servant of God. Now, the word servant, I don't know what comes to mind to you, but here's some explanations of this word. A servant was a person that attends to another for the purpose of performing menial offices or menial tasks for him. So when you think of servant, you probably don't think, ooh, pick me, pick me. I want to be the servant. I want to be the one doing all the serving. Because we kind of know that it's a person who has to do things really that maybe someone else doesn't want to do. You know, serve me. You'll go, you know, do something that I don't want to do. They may or may not have been employed, but they were subject to the other person's commands. So think about all this, but think about it more in the terms of how we would want to serve God. Because we should be willing to do what might seem menial tasks for our Heavenly Father, shouldn't we? If He says, go give a gospel tract, we should say, yes, sir. Might seem a bit menial, might seem a bit mundane, might seem not very impressive by the world's standards, but we're His servant. If He wants us to do some other aspect of service that might seem not very important, we say, that is what I'm going to do because I serve God. And I think you're here this morning because you love the Lord and this is important to you because you know it's important to God. You're probably not going to be able to brag to all of your mates at school tomorrow and all of your colleagues at work, oh, guess what I did this weekend? What? I went to church. They'd be like, okay. And I was there early and I helped out with this, and then I gave out some gospel literature to try to convert people to Christianity. They're not going to be like, that is amazing, tell us more. They're going to think, weirdo, you know. So it's a menial task, but it's the Lord's work, and if it's important to Him, it's important to us because we are His servants, and we don't mind doing menial tasks for our master, the Lord. A servant differs from a slave in that a servant's subjection to his master is voluntary while a slave's is not. Now that's kind of interesting. We always, often when people talk about servant, they say this means slave. And that is kind of part of what the word means. But there is an aspect in which our service to God is voluntary. No one's making us serve God. God could make us serve Him, but He allows us a choice. And so there is a voluntary aspect. I actually quite like that. Sometimes we use the term volunteers for people that serve in the church. It's used in a secular term as well. But we are volunteers. We have been bought with a price. We belong to the Lord, but He still gives us a choice. And that is a wonderful thing to know. I don't have to do this. I get to do this. I have a choice, and I choose to serve God. Now, why would Paul call himself a servant of God? Well, no doubt he felt that this was an appropriate way to describe his relationship with the Lord. He understood that God was God and that he was not. Paul was not. The servant of God. What does it mean to be God? Well, it means you are over everything. You have created everything. You see, service is not that difficult or not that demeaning if it is done for someone who is of great value and honor. I've used this illustration before, but there's almost no task you could do that if you did it for the queen, it wouldn't be an honor. Whatever you might, you know, fill in the blank, but if you're, you know, whatever it is that the world might say, that's not a very important job. If you're like, but it happens at Buckingham Palace, you'd be like, wow, not bad. You know, chief cobweb cleaner in Buckingham Palace. all right then, you know. So the person you serve exalts the task. So for Paul, who was extremely educated, could have been very successful to say servant, you think it's down, but for Paul, he's like, no, that's up, because it's servant of God. So it for Paul, he understood that there was a God that created him. There was a God who saved him. There, remember, Paul was thought he was on the right path, and he is going great, with great energy in this direction. And then Jesus appears to him and says, you're on the wrong path. And his eyes are open, and he is saved, and his sins are forgiven. And so Paul, his life has been radically changed, and he recognizes that there is a God in heaven, and that God is worthy to be served. He says, a servant of God. Now, all through Titus, Paul is going to refer to God as our Savior. Look down at verse number 3. And you might even want to underline these if it's your Bible. Look what it says in verse 3. The commandment of God, our Savior. So he says to Titus, God is our Savior, Titus. He saved you. He saved me. Isn't it great to be saved? He saved us. Now this is interesting. Go to verse number 4. Who's called the Savior in verse 4? Do you see it? Who's called the Savior in verse 4? The Lord Jesus Christ. I thought in verse 3, who is it in verse 3? God. So who's it talking about, God or the Lord Jesus Christ? Sam says, yes, both. It's actually a proof of the deity, or the fact that Jesus is God. And he's going to do that 3 times in the book of Titus. If you go down to chapter 2, look at verse 10. He says, God our Savior. And then verse 13, he says, the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And then once again, in chapter 3, verse 4, God our Savior. And chapter 3, verse 6, Jesus Christ our Savior. That's a very strong proof, or strong statement from Paul, that Jesus is God. But the point that we're trying to make here is that he's our Savior. And he rescued Paul. And so Paul said, I want to serve him because he has been so good to me. You can write down 1 Timothy 1, verses 12 to 17. So, a servant. If you were to walk up to someone today and say, hello, my name is, and they said, oh, what do you do? Would you be comfortable saying, well, really the most important thing I do is I serve God? They might think it's a little weird, and they might be like, what does that mean? But that ought to be our heart, shouldn't it? My job, my life, my focus, before everything else that I do, is I serve God. So that's a great way to introduce yourself. And I hope that you and I would change our mentality from a, how can God serve me and give me everything I want and answer all my prayers and make my life amazing, to how can I serve God? A servant wakes up in the morning, and he doesn't walk in to the master's bedroom, like maybe children sometimes do with their parents, and say, I'm hungry, make me some food. And the parents get up out of bed and they rush down, like, I'll get there, you know. Sorry, I was up till midnight doing the laundry for you, oh child of mine. A servant doesn't do that. A servant, hello, good morning, do you want any coffee? Do you want any toast? How would you like your eggs today, master? That's the servant mentality. And yet we want God to be like, we sometimes parents are treated, we're like, God, you better answer my prayers and you better do this for me. We can't treat God like that. We are the servant. He's the master. We should volunteer ourselves to help him. Number 2, a sent one. A sent one. So a servant, a sent one. Let's look at the rest of verse number 1. He says, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ. So he introduced himself as a servant. Then he says, I'm an apostle. Now, the word apostle means someone who is sent on a mission to represent the interests of someone else. It's used quite frequently in the Bible. It's also translated in some places as messenger. So apostles of Jesus Christ were men who were directly commissioned by Jesus Christ to speak and to act on behalf of Jesus, especially in spreading the gospel and laying the foundation of the church. So there was a personal connection with Jesus himself. They were taught by him. They had seen him. They were witnesses of his resurrection. And this connection with the personal connection with Jesus Christ himself indicates that there are no longer any apostles of Jesus Christ in this original sense. But there is a sense in which all of us should have a I will be sent spirit. I'm willing to allow the Lord Jesus Christ to send me wherever he wants me to go, to do his work, whatever he wants me to do. And as we talked about in our last series on spiritual gifts, he in a sense has authorized us, just like he said to Paul and to Peter and to the other apostles, I want you and I want you to go represent me. He has said that to us. He wants us to represent him. He wants us to be sent out into the world as his witnesses, as his messengers to give his message to the world. Let me show you, let me see if I have that verse here. We'll look at that verse in a little bit, even though you don't know what verse I'm talking about. I was going to look at a verse, but we'll go to it in just a little bit. So the difficulty is that we often get comfortable and content and complacent, and we don't want to be sent. We sort of think of this in terms of missionaries. Well, missionaries, they have to just go wherever God wants them to go, and they got to have a good attitude, and if they don't, we don't like them, we won't support them. You know, well, you're a missionary. You're just supposed to do whatever God wants you to do. Now, me, on the other hand, I'm not a missionary. I get to stay right where I'm at and do whatever I want because God has not called me to such a life. But all of us should have that missionary attitude in heart, that willingness to say, Lord, here am I, send me. Now let's look at some reasons of why Paul was willing to serve and why he was willing to be sent. And we're going to have to go through these kind of quickly. But number one, we see that he wanted more people to be saved. Look at verse number one again, according to the faith of God's elect. So Paul says, I'm a servant and I'm an apostle in accordance with the faith of God's elect. Now the word elect here means chosen. But the important thing to understand about this word is chosen for what or to what? Often when people think about elect, they think it has to do with God choosing people to salvation. God chose some to be saved. But the idea of election is really not that God has chosen to salvation, but that he has chosen to certain blessings and certain aspects of service. So the Bible actually says that he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, not to be saved. This is Ephesians 1, 4, and 5. Maybe if you could put that one up there if you see it. But chosen us that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So when God chooses, he doesn't say, I'm going to save you and you and you and you. That's not what election and predestination are really talking about. What he has chosen is, he says, you know what, I'm going to choose that everybody who believes on Jesus will stand before me holy and without blame before me in love. It's choosing to certain blessings, and it's choosing for service. That's really what it's talking about. So the faith of God's elect, he is saying, I'm going out and serving the Lord. I am going out and doing what He wants me to do because I want more and more people to get in on the blessings that are available when they believe on Jesus. How do you become, or how do you receive the blessings of being elect? Titus chapter 1 verse 1 says faith. What is Paul saying? He's saying, I go and I serve because I want more people to believe and to receive the blessings of being God's chosen. The blessings of being saved. He's saying, I serve because I want to see more people saved. So we should want to see more people saved. We should want more people to get in on the blessings of salvation. Secondly, he wants to see more people sanctified. Verse 1, he says, according to the faith of God's elect. And then secondly, the acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness. So he says, I want them to have the faith of God's elect, and I want them to acknowledge the truth, which is after godliness. To acknowledge means a thorough acquaintance, a full or thorough knowledge. It's like, I acknowledge, I accept this. No, you're right, I get it, I understand. And we sometimes live in denial about lots of things, but this is, I accept the truth, and then look what happens. Where does that truth lead us to? It's after what? Godliness. So the idea here is, he doesn't want just people getting saved, he wants people becoming more like God. And Paul recognizes that if he will serve and he will go, more and more people will get saved and more people receive not only the gift of salvation, but the gift of becoming more and more like God. Sometimes when we think about God and we think about what God says, it's almost like God is up in heaven dreaming, how can he make us more miserable? Kind of like young people think about their parents. Their parents, they stay up till all hours of the night. What can we do tomorrow that our kids just really hate? Let's send them to school. You know, let's make them eat vegetables. Let's not allow them to sit on their PlayStations for 18 hours a day. They'll really hate that. Perfect. God's not like that. God is thinking, what's best? And believe it or not, some parents actually want what's best for their kids. And that's hard to believe, but I think it's actually true. And God wants our best. And so to become like God is the best thing for us. And so Paul says, I'm going and I'm serving because I want more and more people to acknowledge the truth that's going to be after godliness. Verse number 2, when people get saved, they get a hope. A hope, look at verse 2, a hope of what? Hope of eternal life. The hope here is different than a hope so. Sometimes you ask people, so if something was to happen to you, do you know that you would go to heaven when you die? And what do a lot of people say? Well, I hope so. What does that mean? I mean, I'm not real sure. But I hope there's a miracle or something at the end and, you know, just works out. Because right now, I really have no idea. It's kind of a desire, I think, to be humble, isn't it? Because you're like, well, I don't want to say I know. Yes. But the hope here is different. This is like a confidence. This is an assurance. He says, when I serve and follow the Lord and go out, I want to see more people saved. I want to see more people becoming like God. I want more people to have the hope of eternal life. The confidence, the assurance that they are going to have life with God for all of eternity. It's a life that never ends, and it's a life that is the life of God. So it's quantity and quality. It's both aspects. The hope of eternal life. I mean, this is a great verse for you because we need assurance. What is the hope of eternal life? How can we know? How can someone say, oh, I know I'll go to heaven when I die? I mean, how arrogant. How prideful. Well, this hope here is not based upon us. Look what the verse says. Hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. For you and I to say, I know I have eternal life, is if we've trusted in Jesus and obeyed what God says in His Word, that is not an arrogant thing. That is a submissive thing to the promise of God. Sometime before the world began, God made a promise that He was going to give eternal life to everyone that believed on Him. And God, guess what? There's something God cannot do. What can God not do? He cannot lie. There's actually other things God can't do. He can't do anything that goes against His character. So somebody says, can God make a rock so big He can't lift it? You would say, no, He cannot, because He can't go against His own character. He also can't fail. I think there's a little children's song about that. But He cannot lie. I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? And so if God says something, you can take it to the bank. It's guaranteed because He made the promise. And when it comes to eternal life, we can rest in knowing we have salvation if we've trusted in Jesus, because God has given His Word. In Hebrews it says He could not swear by anyone greater. Like when He makes a promise, He says, I mean, what book does God put His hand upon whenever He makes a promise? I think, you know, He's like, I just put my hand on myself, you know, because He's the highest. We put our hand on His book. So we have this hope. Well, we're not going to make it through. I'd hoped we would get through the passage, but we're going to have to continue this next week because we want to have the Lord's Supper together. But I would go back and ask you, and I'll give you the third word so you can fill in your outline. The third word is a son. Okay, so now you can feel good. Susan's like, I can rest. I've got all three main points there. And they all begin with S. A servant, a sent one, and a son. We'll talk about that a little bit more next week. But what is your attitude towards God? Do you see yourself as a servant? Do you see yourself as a sent one? And where is your confidence? Is it in what you can do, or is it in God who promised eternal life, and that life is found in His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ? Let's just close in prayer, and then Sam's going to come lead us in the observance of the Lord's Supper. Heavenly Father, thank You for who You are. Thank You for what You've done. Thank You that You have saved all who trust in You. And I pray if there's someone here today who's never believed on Jesus, that they would believe and that they would be saved and they would receive this great confidence and hope of eternal life. And for those of us who have received that, God, help us to serve You and help us to be willing to be sent by You wherever You might have us go. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Come in, Sam.
Well, thank you so much. That was wonderful. I love the book of Titus. I've preached through it once before, so it's a little bit of not really old hat, but it's exciting to see it again. And it's just a great book. I feel like it's, well, we'll get into what I think about it later on. I'm bound to have to preach part of it. But if you'll turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. This is exciting to get a chance to enjoy the Lord's Supper. And to get to this, it has been a while since I've done it, and Travis mentioned it earlier this week, and it's so exciting. I've only done it ever in the UK. In America, they obviously don't trust me with it, so thank you for trusting me. But it's a wonderful time. The Lord's Supper, one of my favorite things about being saved and about knowing the Lord is the relationship that we have with Him. And communion is about that relationship. The Lord's Supper is about that relationship and about spending time with Him and remembering what He's done for us. And we're, you know, today is our Remembrance Sunday, so it's almost perfect. I don't know if it was planned that way. Probably so. But to remember what He has done for us in giving His Son and what the Lord did for us in His death and in His burial and His resurrection. And so as we look at this passage, very quickly, there are two things we really need to see. We need to see what we're doing, but then is what we need to see, that we need to examine ourselves before we get into this, because this is not something to be lightly entered into. If you'll look with me at verses 26 through 31 very quickly in 1 Corinthians 11, it says, "For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till He come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat of this bread and drink of this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. So we see that there's a significance to communion. This shows the picture of what has happened on the cross and what happened in the death and the burial and the resurrection. So it's a beautiful picture that's shown. And then it gives some qualifiers for doing communion. So first qualifier is being saved. We have to know the Lord in salvation. If we don't know Him and we're not saved, then we don't need to be partaking. Today is the day to get saved. And then the other thing is to examine ourselves and make sure that we're living right, so that we have confessed our sins, so that we have forsaken the sins that we are that maybe we have had trouble with. The great thing about communion and the time we get to take is it's kind of like a check-in and a self-inspection to sit down and say, okay, where am I growing? Where am I falling? Where am I? What have I? Have I had? Do I have a problem? Lord, show that to me and help me to cleanse that away and get rid of it. But in just a couple of minutes, we're going to take and just have a time for you to privately assess your heart, to talk to the Lord and say, do I have an issue? Is there something we need to talk about? And to get that clear, because there are consequences for not properly examining ourselves. In the Corinthian church, the way they were doing it, it was getting quite rough because many people were sick, and even some of these people had died. So communion is not something to play with. Now, there is no saving power in communion. Let me help you understand that. This is not going to save your soul. It is not something you have to participate in to be a good to be right with the Lord. And honestly, if you don't feel worthy, we're not watching to make sure you take. And if you don't partake, we're not going to come find you. But we don't want you just to partake and not have taken this time to assess and taken this time to get right with the Lord if you're having trouble with it. So we're going to take about a minute or so, and we're just going to bow our heads, close our eyes, let y'all pray, and then I will pray, and then the men will come and we'll distribute. Father, we thank you again for this time that we get to come and share in the Lord's Supper, and Lord, the time we get to spend worshiping you this way. Father, we thank you, God, that we can come and confess our sins and get right. And Lord, we pray that today you would just bless us, help us, and use this as a time that we can spend with you, Lord, and worship you in this time. Father, thank you for everything in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. If Jonathan and Loveday would come forward and help distribute. So the first thing we see in verse 24 that it says, I can find it again in my Bible. And when he had given them thanks, he broke the bread and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Would you mind praying for the bread? So the second thing we see in verse number 25, it says, after the same manner also, he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, this is the cup of the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink in remembrance of me. Loveday, would you mind praying for the Jews? Well, amen. Loveday is going to come, and he's going to lead us in our final song. And then if you wouldn't mind praying to close out the service, that would be great.
If we can all please rise as we sing our last song.
You.
just want to thank you for a wonderful day today. We give you all the thanks and praise for everything you have done today. We thank you for your word that came so powerful. Father, help us to live by your word, and help us, oh God, to grow in your word. We give you all the thanks and praise. We commit the week ahead into your able hands. We pray that, Lord, you continue to guide us in Jesus' name.